remember the first time we ever interviewed with Honeywell was in March of 1952. That was the year of the big snow in Minnesota, and we were both in school. Daddy was finishing up his PhD, and I was finishing up my bachelor's in home economics. And we came up at spring break to interview with Honeywell. We got as far as Albert Lea, and it was snowing like crazy. We decided to see if we could make it all the way and kept going. And we got as far as Geneva. This was on the old road, two-lane roads, and we had to turn around and go back. The highway patrol had the highway closed. So we went back, got the last room in Albert Lea, and stayed overnight. The next day we came on up to Minneapolis, and I have never, ever experienced such deep, sloshy slush, because the next day it warmed up and everything was melty. And they took us to Charlie's for dinner that night. Charlie's was the big, fanciest, nicest restaurant in Minneapolis, downtown Minneapolis. But Daddy decided to follow his major professor to New Jersey, to Bendix. So we went to New Jersey for 2.5 years, and that's where Burgess was born. And then we came back to Honeywell. And by then they had moved the lab from downtown, the main headquarters, which is where the main headquarters is now, much smaller then. They had moved it from there out to Hopkins, to the old poor farm, the county home out in Hopkins on, let's see, would that be 7th Avenue South or something like that in Hopkins. And I think somewhere else on this video, Wendy maybe has a picture of the old lab. But he was one of the pioneers, not the very first person, people to be out there, but very soon after they started. And I remember that old building. It was neat, with the gravel pit across the street where Daddy used to go pick up rocks, and we got some big ones that he picked up over there, agates, things like that. And he'd come home at lunch every day, which was kind of neat. The kids were little, and so every noon was lunch with everybody. And then when they moved down to Bloomington, everybody had to figure out carpools, and he didn't come home for lunch anymore, and it was a lot farther to go. Different kind of atmosphere, but it was like one big family over there in Hopkins. And that was neat.
Well, he's a scientist and he knows a lot of things about lots of things. And a lot of other people don't know that much about what he knows about. Well, he knows about lots of kind of rocks and dinosaur bones and plants.
Oh, yeah.
Maps. Well, he types, because wherever I go, he's always typing on his typewriter, on his computer.
What do you think he's writing?
Probably information either to send to someone, if he's typing it on the typewriter, or if he's typing it on the computer, he's probably putting in information so he can keep it and always know about it.
Huh. Is that part of his, you had a word for it, research?
Yeah, research.
Yeah.
Doing a lot of research all the time, too.
The year was 1955, and Robert Glenn Johnson embarked on a career move that influenced his entire scientific and personal life. Robert, known to most as Bob, was hired at the Honeywell Research Laboratory on April 15th, 1955, to begin work.
Moving from the temperate climate of the New Jersey coastline of the eastern United States, Bob returned to the upper Midwest with his wife, Betty, and six-month-old son, Burgess. And I can see why to these communities of Minnesota, Minneapolis, and later Hopkins, Minnetonka, the community suburb that Bob and Betty still call home. A young and talented, as well as handsome, Bob Johnson began at the age of 32 his first 35 years of scientific research at this site. The original lab is no longer here. All that remains is the ground I'm walking on and the few older trees that witnessed the birth and destruction of the Honeywell Research Laboratory. The property now is home to Warrington Associates Incorporated. Originally, the building was the Hennepin County work farm for the poor and destitute of this previously rural area. The Honeywell Regulator Company was the next occupant of the sturdy old red brick building, bringing into it the minds and secret research of brilliant brains like that of Dr. Robert Glenn Johnson. But soon that good old lab building couldn't possibly contain that prosperous growth of Honeywell's needs, nor the demands of the latest scientific technology, bigger, better equipment, and modern facilities. 1970s, the new Honeywell Research Lab staff moved into the former Archer Daniels Midland building, overlooking the Minnesota River Bluffs area of Bloomington, Minnesota. Town, some 18 miles from the original Hopkins site, was an adjustment for many. Some employees chose to relocate their families to the Bloomington area, yet others, after weighing the pros and cons, decided to remain in the Hopkins, Minnetonka area. This was born the infamous carpool, where environmentally and pocketbook concerned Honeywell folks joined forces for the long haul to and from the new research lab. Today, the research lab houses approximately 200-some employees and supports anywhere from 30 to 40 individual scientific projects at one time. It continues to be the home to Honeywell's future in the world of scientific measuring devices and other assorted endeavors. And this brings us now, November 25th, 1989, to the last days of Bob Johnson's professional career at the Honeywell Research Laboratory. The last 35 years have certainly brought about more than just nifty gadgets, mysterious explosions, or top secret government research. It has influenced in a positive way many, many people, family, friends, colleagues, strangers, all of us. This is Miriam Johnson reporting.
I was very nervous about meeting him because he was a physicist and I was supposed to be a physicist too. And I just knew that I was probably not going to know what he was talking about. And I was going to go home. And I went to visit the lab and there were a lot of electrons. I kind of had to try to sound. I didn't want to sound like an idiot, so I tried to sound. It's not in my head a lot. It's like, oh yeah, yeah. but over the years, that's been a real pleasure talking to your dad, talking to Bob about this whole thing. And he's a neat way of thinking about things. I'm real glad that Burgess's dad is a physicist. Last night, Burgess and I were talking about what you're.
And
we thought, well, Burgess said that maybe there'll be something really different, like engineers. I didn't think that was different. I said, well, as long as they're really lawyers. And he said, oh, they'll never end up being lawyers. I mean, that would be like a lawyer's kid ending up being a physicist. One thing that I really appreciated about Bob is the breadth of interest. Stuff at work and his tree stuff and his glacier stuff and he's really well versed in all of those things. It just astounds me that he can have all those things at the same time.
What do you do or what's he like?
He types a lot. He's a he's gonna be a professor at the U. Inventions.
Mm.
And he does a lot of research.
Yeah, sounds like a busy guy. Tell me about what's it like when you go over to the Johnson house.
Well, he's always typing.
What's he typing?
like information into the computer to store it, and if he does it on the typewriter, it's for someone else.
Okay.
Their information.
Tell me about the last thing you did with Grandpa Bob.
We went to the play called The Shoemaker and the Elves. And afterwards, we went to the McDonald's to have a snack.
Who is we?
Saha, Laura, Daniel, and me.
And who, well, who drove you?
Grandpa Bob.
Oh, just Grandpa Bob. Mm-hmm. Huh. Is that something you'd like to do again?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I can remember two things. I can remember when we'd all jump in the car with Mama on the days that she had the car, and she would haul us over to the lab, and we'd pick up Daddy, and we'd sit there, and we'd try to figure out which window was his, and we'd wave and wave until we'd finally see somebody waving, and I think sometimes somebody had to poke him to go wave. He said, "Hey, your kids are down there waving their heads off," and he'd go to the window, and he'd wave at us, and we'd all wave back, and then we'd give him a ride home. And then they'd have these tours occasionally of the lab, where they'd have an open house, and people could come with their families. And I remember when Burgess got to look in the electron microscope, but I also remember especially the glass blowers, the guys that made the... The guys that made the test tubes and bottles, but when they had the open house, they didn't just make flasks and bottles and test tubes and things. They'd make these beautiful little glass swans. I think they really were getting into their artistry when the kids showed up. They were tired of doing test tubes, and they liked to have an appreciative audience. And then I remember at home when I was little, and we'd wait for Daddy to come home, and he'd always park the car in the driveway or in the garage, and come in through the kitchen door from the garage. And I can remember standing behind the kitchen door, and he'd come home, and I'd get squashed behind the door, and then I'd jump out and grab his leg and go, boo! Like, as if he didn't know I was there. That's probably the earliest memories that I have. And my kids do it to us now, so we carry it on. And John talked about the glaciation stuff, and I have here the very first poster for the very first poster paper. And I can remember Daddy driving me back to school my sophomore year. He always seemed to be the one who'd drive me back to school, and we'd get in these big, long, philosophical conversations and delving into our family histories and who was like who in the family tree and all this stuff. But it was always really interesting for me to learn a little bit about the family history and find out more about what life was like before I came along. And Daddy, I remember when Daddy was real excited about this paper, and he told me all about it on the way down to St. Olaf. And the next time he picked me up, he told me about the next developments along the way. And what else? Oh, and I can, another vivid memory I can remember is going out on top of the garage roof. Daddy'd get the big ladder out and put it up, and then he'd get the big old kind of pea green army blanket, and he'd lay it out on top of the roof, and the kids, Burgess and Janie and I'd all crawl up there, and we'd lay down on our backs, digging our heels in to keep from sliding off over the gutters. And Daddy'd be up there, and we'd have the binoculars sometimes, and we'd just lay there on our backs like that, and he'd point out all the constellations, and he'd point out all the stars, and he'd point out the big red star over there, and then he'd point out where Jupiter was, and Saturn, and Venus, and Mars, and he'd point in the moon, and the periods of the moon. Yeah. And that I always liked. And occasionally we'd see a shooting star. We'd go up in the end of August, or in the middle of August, when the Euripides shower was going on. And, or is it Perseus? Anyway, the meteor shower. And we'd go up there, and we'd see who could see the most stars shooting down. I think Daddy had a real fascination with the sky. He was going to be an astronomer at one point in his younger life, and he liked to pass that excitement on to us. And he sent me a star map when I was in the Peace Corps in Yemen, and I remember crawling up on our hands and knees up to the roof of the house where we were in our training time with another volunteer, and we brought blankets with us. And the reason we're on our hands and knees is because we didn't want the neighbors to see us, because they would appreciate the fact that we were up on the roof in the middle of the night. But we went up there and we laid the blankets down and covered up to get warm, and we took our star map and we held it over our faces, and we figured out where all the constellations were there, because there were no city lights in that place where we were so we could see lots of stars like I've never seen them before. Mm. And something else. Oh! Sort of carrying on that interest with the sky. I can remember once when I was a kid and we were in the old house, the first house, the one that Daddy built. And there was kind of, the weather was in a lot of turmoil that year, and there was one storm where we had lots and lots of tornadoes that devastated the area around Lake Minnetonka. And we got outside in the yard and the sky is all that kind of sickly green, like people look just before they puke, you know, that really awful green. The sky was gonna do it. And we could see, we counted 7 different twister clouds at the same time that we could see. We saw the big, huge one that just was like a big, huge suction cup over Lake Minnetonka's horizon. Then we could see a couple to the north and a couple to the northeast and a couple to the west and a couple to the east. And the only direction we couldn't see was to the south because we were blocked by trees. And this is just, it was really a fascinating thing, this big, terrible green skied storm where everybody looked sort of pea green in the face, reflecting the light of the sky. And I remember standing out in the backyard with Daddy and with Burgess. And we're standing out there looking up at the sky and these weird clouds, and all of a sudden we saw 2 whirlpools just went right over us. And the sky, 2 big whirlpools in the clouds. And we sit out there and Daddy goes, "Hey, look at that! Isn't that interesting?" "Well, yeah, wow, that's really cool." And we just watched them go over. And it wasn't until like the next day that we realized how really dumb that was, because they were probably tornadoes up in the clouds that just had gone up at the time. They went right over the house, just whirlpools in the clouds, really spinning like that. Mm. And you know, if they decided to come down, they would have just picked us up and taken us back up with them, you know, beam me up, Charlie. And, but it was still really fascinating. I was glad that we were there. I'm just really glad that you're my dad. I couldn't ask for a better dad. And I just want you to know that a lot of those things, not just the things that I talked about, but other things too, I try to pass on to my own kids.
His telescope. And then this one's a picture of it.
Is that the article in the paper?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. What's that piece of paper with those notes on it?
Where?
On the table.
The music notes.
Show that for the camera. Put it up on your show. Yeah. I'm gonna zoom in on it. And what's this that you're showing here? What is this?
The music for the song that Grandpa Bob made.
What's the song called?
I don't know. Did he give us a name?
In Neptune Far Away.
In Neptune Far Away.
Oh.
He plays an instrument.
What?
He plays an instrument.
Oh, tell us. What's that?
I don't remember the name of the instrument. Trombone.
Oh. You like that?
Yeah. Yeah. How were the pageant this year at church?
I was an undergrad at the time.
Oh, you're an undergrad at the time? Oh, at the U?
At the University of Minnesota. Huh. And in astrophysics, of all things. But that was another thing. It seemed like, I think Bob, when he was in school, had wanted to go into astronomy, and Jolie also had an interest in astronomy. And some of the other people, Kirk Nixon, were were interested in astronomy a long time ago, so it was like I started off the same track and found out, gee, there's no jobs here. And he was helpful in making that decision for me. When I finished my degree, it was, well, I think maybe now it's time to do something useful. And the things that I was doing at work with Bob helped me make the decision. Started off, I was supposed to be doing some kind of, I think it was a gas chromatograph on a silicon chip. Cho Lee had a thing about trying to get that done. He just wanted to experiment to see what techniques that were actually being used for the making gas chromatograph. And so I was supposed to play around with all these chemicals, and I had chemicals all over the place, wearing rubber gloves all day long. But we finally came around to doing some of this anisotropic research finally.
Yeah.
And when I started getting into that, Cho introduced me to Bob and said, you know, here's some things that Bob would like to see. And I think we made some, Bob was working with Stan Tibbetts at the time. And we made some cantilever beams out of silicon. It was really crude. Couldn't figure out any use for it, but it was neat. Bob would usually I'd get a cup of cocoa and he'd have his tea. And we'd sit down in his office and we'd just kind of brainstorm and we'd scribble things on the board. And I think we must have had about, almost all of our inventions came out of that.
Cocoa tea breaks.
Yeah, coffee break. Well, cool. Not coffee, but whatever.
Okay.
It was a long time before I was there. I just heard about it one time. All I know was that they were, I don't know if they were pumping something through they pulled some gases in one of the tubes in. And I don't know the whole mechanism. I just know that the whole lab kind of blew up.
Oof.
I think one of the things that got Bob his notoriety was after his fall and the raccoon was the asleep on the bedpan story. I'd go down to Microswitch sometimes and talk to the people down there and they go, oh yeah, you work with Bob, he's the one that wrote that story, isn't he? They had nothing to do with what we were doing, but they heard of his story.
What was the story?
Asleep on the bedpan. We always had fun in our meetings too, with both of us being named Bob. And if we were sitting next to each other, somebody would say, Bob, and then we'd both look and go, oh, that one. I think at some point they gave us, Bob Johnson was Bob 1 and I was Bob 2. And when they gave us the sweat awards, they called us the Bobs. Us Iowans.
Are you from Iowa?
I was born in Dubuque.
Oh.
Although he's Swedish, right? I'm half Norwegian.
Really? Well, he's half Swedish and half English and a lot of other things.
I'm half Norwegian and half Japanese, so we hit it off.
Yep, bye bye.
Smile for
Gretchen. Gretchen.
I don't think we have time to focus on it right now.
Mr. X, I've been putting some numbers and figures down on paper, and do you think you could take a look at them?
No, Bob, we don't have our eyeglasses on today, so we can't focus on it right now.
Mr. X, I've really been looking at some great applications for this device, and I think it really would be quite profitable for Honeywell if we look into it. What do you say?
No, Bob, we just don't have the budget to focus on it right now.
Mr. X, I have been talking to some of my colleagues. Mr. X? I've been talking to some of my colleagues, and they really think that this airflow project shows great creativity and productivity for the department. Do you agree?
No, Bob. We're too buried in trivial paperwork to pursue it right now.
Wait, have you read the paper yesterday?
What?
Have you read the paper today?
The paper?
Yeah. There's a really interesting article about
Honeywell.
Where?
Right here on the front page.
Oh, yeah! Whoops. What's this, Sunday? Oh, this is Sunday's,
Star Tribune.
Or the December 15th, 1999, huh?
Yeah.
What's this? Honeywell sold. Trump wins bid. RG Johnson microchip goes for $11 billion? Honeywell announced yesterday afternoon that it has sold its shares of stock to renowned billionaire Donald Trump after fierce bidding for 10 weeks. Hitachi, General Electric, and Lockheed were all contenders for the Honeywell fortune, or rather, the RG Johnson Microchip Enterprises, as it was commonly nicknamed. Daddy never mentioned that. The RG Johnson Microchip Airflow Sensor was the pride of the company after its initial invention in the 1980s by Dr. Robert Johnson, the now famous physicist, you bet, father of modern cold fusion theory and applied physics. The microchip division of Honeywell, which makes up 95% of the company assets, sold for $11 billion, while the remaining assets of the company sold for $4.03. Speculation during the previous week had raised the price of Honeywell stock from $34.25 on Monday to its $278.75 per share on Friday. Wow. Look at this quote. The Honeywell National Monument, it is the best we can do to honor the man that has saved the world from self-destruction. It is ironic that the beginnings of the microchip sensor was not such a pretty story. In the beginning stages, Honeywell management failed to recognize potential profit and longevity of the basic chip designs. Mr. Trump announced after the closing of the deal that he would keep the Bloomington Honeywell Research Site as a national historical monument. It's the best. Oh, it's continued on page 25.
That's interesting.
Well, let's see. One of my first memories was an open house at the old Honeywell building that was on County Road 18, just south of the Highway Department building. And I remember sitting down in Daddy's desk chair and thinking, so this is where he works. It didn't look much like an office to me because there were all sorts of pieces of equipment and things around. And I pictured it as an office from the Dick Van Dyke Show or
really?
Whatever.
Really?
So it was a little different. And I remember Burgess could understand an awful lot more of what Grandpa Bob was talking about than I could. That's about it for my
late memories.
Later on, I remember Diane and I entered some art pieces in the Honeywell children's. Honeywell employees, children of employees, yeah. Art contest, and Diane did a black cut paper ant height level cross section of grass and other and insects, and I did some felt cut. Felt picture
squirrels
of
and trees.
Yeah, I remember I used a lot of olive green and different greens. That was when green was my favorite color. So I used, I had a squirrel climbing a tree. That's about all I remember of what the pieces looked like. I remember going down to the main headquarters building in Minneapolis where they had everything nicely displayed for a little art show. And Diane's gotten an award. So that was kind of fun. And one other time when he first got awarded a sweat award, and I remember going to a big auditorium. I assume this was probably at the main headquarters building. There was a big auditorium, a lot of people there, and a stage that seemed so huge. And Daddy got up on the stage with a lot of other people and got his award. And I remember there were about 8 Japanese guys up there, too. And I thought, what are those Japanese guys doing up there? I asked Mama, and she said, Honeywell has some facilities in Japan, too. And I guess that's when I first realized that Honeywell was a lot bigger company than I ever realized. It was more than just the research building in Hopkins
really?
And the big one downtown.
Hi, Grandpa Bob. Yeah, nice to see you again, too. Yeah. Well, how have you been? You know, I'm glad I'm getting interviewed, and no, it's not just because I like being on TV. It's because I have something to say to you. But first, let me give you a big kiss. Let me wipe my mouth on here. Just a second, I gotta go. Oh, just a second, I gotta see Pat. Hi, I'm back again. Well, like I was saying, well, maybe I should lie down. Like I was saying, I am... it's been a long day. Like I was saying, Grandpa, when you first met me, you didn't discriminate against me because I was big and slobbery. You know, you were good friends with Tanuki, but you were still nice to me. And, yes, gosh darn it. You know, I would get so excited when you give me a bone. Bam. I would hit bam. Yeah, I would just paw my way to that bone if I could. Yep, those dog bones, they were so good. And if you didn't bring one, yeah, give me that one, would you? Okay. All right, I'll take it. Ah, thank you. Let me outside now so I don't make a mess, Grandpa Bob. Yeah, right out here in the back. Yeah, I know it's cold, but I can handle it. I like the cold. Yeah, open it there. Thank you. I'll just eat it right out here on the snow. Yeah, it's so cold it steams up the window, but hey, I can take it. This is good. Oh, Grandpa Bob. Yeah, happy retirement.
Well, the first encounter I had was coming over to the house on March Circle with Diane and Rachel to pick up the clipper. And Bob greeted us at the door so warmly, and he said, come on in and have some lunch. And he had a table full of food you wouldn't believe. He had sandwich meat and bread to feed us, and we had a beautiful lunch, and we had, it must have been raspberry season that day, eh?
A big pan of raspberries.
I couldn't believe. I never saw that many raspberries in one place, in one container before. Anyway,
really, not frozen.
And we had a great lunch, and it was a beautiful introduction for me to Bob. Because I am a engineer and a scientist, I have an interest in the things that Bob does in his work, but especially his avocational research on glacial cycles. And well, we've had many an interesting conversation about all that stuff. I have followed that very closely. Just now I get Scientific American, and the latest issue has an article about the glacial cycles by an arch rival of Bob's from out east. So I know all about this guy. I kind of take what he says with a grain of salt. Because I got the inside story from the guy who really knows.
Papers and patents. Dr. Robert G. Johnson. Astronomer. Physicist. Chemist. Engineer. Scientist. Man of knowledge, method, and discovery. Dr. Johnson published numerous papers and filed numerous patents. His first corporate publication in Physics Review in 1953, entitled MS Spectrometric Positive Ion Technique for Determining Transition Temperatures and Heats of Transformation in Metals. His second corporate publication appeared in J. Chemic Society Physics. And
And after 23 patents and 11 corporate publications and 4 external publications, his fifth and last external publication, entitled Glacial Terminations in the Oxygen Isotope Record of Deep Sea Cores, Hypothesis of Massive Antarctic Ice Shelf Destruction. This appeared in Paleogeography, Paleoclimatology, Paleoecology,
1986. He likes stars.
No, Salaha. Try it again. What was that?
He likes stars.
Oh. What else do you know about Grandpa Bob?
He loves apples.
Tell me about that.
He eats them up and then he gets some more.
Where to get them?
From the grocery store.
Can you tell me what you and Grandpa Bob did last summer? Did you go someplace to pick something special?
No. Oh yeah, we went canoeing down that place one time, and then we went picking everything last summer.
What did you pick? Strawberries?
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah.
Oh, I need that. See?
What's this? Oh, where was that taken?
Canoeing. That's the picture where we went canoeing.
I can take it out of the frame if it's a glare.
No, it's okay. Yeah. Is that one of your favorite pictures?
Yep, I love that with me and Grandpa.
The only things that I remember the most, well, the things I remember the most at the lab would be the open houses, because we'd always go to the open houses and they have like little trinkets that you could pick up and stuff like that. And the one time I remember the most would be the time that we all went downstairs to the glass. Thanks for the feet. Downstairs, the guy was blowing glass, and he blew a glass bell that had silver inside, and he gave it, he said, okay, well, anybody want this, and he happened to give it to me, and I still have it, it's hanging on the tree at home, and Daddy would get home at 10 to 5 every day, 10 to 5, unless he had to work late, and that's all I remember about the lab, really.
How about other things besides the lab?
Well, tree coring. The first time we ever went hiking, Daddy was gonna take me to Lorelei Lake because I'd never been there before. And he didn't take his topographical map, but he drew his own map of, okay, here's Silas and here's Nameless and here's the peak and here's Lorelei. And we had that in our pocket. And we happened to get lost. This is the first time I've ever been hiking with him and we got lost. And it was just funny because, I have the map, like, I'm fine, we're okay. So we got lost. But. whenever we went on a hike, he'd always stop somewhere and look up at a tree and go, pick a needle and go like this with it.
Looks like a fir.
Yep, looks like a fir. Or whatever, and he'd always be identifying trees left and right. Or, hey, here's a bristlecone pine, look at that.
That was probably right after I met Janie, I think. And Bob was telling me about the experiments and things that he was doing at Honeywell. And I was quite interested in particularly in the things that he was doing in the computer area, so that was very interesting to me.
Oh, yeah. What kind of things were those?
I'm trying to think back what he was working on at the time. It was probably something to do with the flow control sensor, although that might have been a little bit after. We talked about so many things that's right, rocking doesn't help, does it?
I know what's going on.
There were so many things that I was working on during that time period. I guess I don't quite recall.
Way. Bob didn't limit his scientific interest to only Honeywell-related topics. Climate and geological history of the Earth were areas of great personal interest. One creative outlet regarding the area of paleoclimatology was the study of ancient subalpine trees in the mountains. Bob took samples from Dinosaur National Monument, Utah, Sangre de Cristo Mountains in southern Colorado, just above the Sand Dunes National Monument, Gros Ventre Pass in the Wind River Range of Wyoming, above Granite Creek Campground. After climbing to altitudes averaging 10,500 feet above sea level, Bob would personally take a sample of the tree, either by sawing a slice of a dead tree or later through more sophisticated means by taking a core sample of a live tree. Kinds of trees that Bob sampled were the bristlecone pine, Engelmann spruce, and the subalpine fir, besides a number of other assorted hardy subalpine trees. Is that fascinated Bob so? We're anywhere from 250 to 353 years old. That means, as seen in the subalpine fir and its graft data, the tree was a seedling quite close to the birth of the discovery of Plymouth Rock in the year 16. Here you see the core style tree samples taken from Coney Mountain in 1985. You see a sample of the Engelmann spruce, the gray bark pine, and the subalpine fir. But as you can see, slabs and cores have the advantages and disadvantages for study purposes. Sampling shown here was taken from Dinosaur National Monument, Utah. What's the age of this small piece of wood? About 339 years old. These photos were taken above Sand Dunes National Monument in the Sangre de Cristo Mountains. The first two photos on the left give you an idea of the terrain and the altitude type of vegetation at this spot where the ancient trees grow. Bob is in action sampling a dead tree by use of the Seven Saw method. Both Wendy in 1982 and Miriam in 1988 show off a young bristlecone pine on the Sangre de Cristo Ridge. The spectacular Gros Ventre Pass in Wyoming's Wind River Range is a challenge all by itself just to reach. By hiking all day from Granite Creek Campground, you reach the summit. Bob, on separate occasions, has taken Burgess, Diane, Wendy, and Miriam to this breathtaking summit. Every time, snow, altitude, wild animals have been present and made the task of sampling the trees a challenge. As long as Bob has the fit legs to hike,
and the trusty topo map, he'll no doubt continue the study of these silent witnesses to centuries of rains, droughts, pestilence, and disease. But for that matter, as long as his children and grandchildren have legs to hike, he'll be studying the harvested samples for a long, long time.
Honestly, Daddy has been a big influence on me. I tried to think of specific examples of how he's been a big influence on me. And it's kind of hard to think of specific examples, but I could think of a few. Like when I was little, Daddy used to take me on Saturday mornings to various electronics junk stores, places like that in downtown Minneapolis, sort of generally kind of run down parts of town, but and the electronics was kind of run down, but it was, you know, salvage stuff that you could wire up into, you know, radios and things. How None old, of my radios ever worked.
But, how old were you then?
Oh, I don't remember. It must have been about 10 years old. Mm-hmm. I must have been about 10 years old or something like that. But that was kind of fun. I guess I've always sort of admired Daddy's wide interest in lots of different things, in physics and geology and the ice ages and archaeology. You know, when the Vikings came over to North America.
Yeah.
All sorts of, just, he's just interested in a whole bunch of different things, sort of. He's sort of a naturalist, kind of. Biology is another of his interests.
Holistic science.
Well, maybe. And I've tried to do the same thing, I guess. I've also admired his creativity in what he does in science, like the latest example is his ideas on cold fusion, and trying to explain that, and his ideas on making a microbridge airflow sensor. That's sort of taking a technology that a lot of people knew about, but using his, coming up with a nice idea that converted it into something that Honeywell could really use in their product line. And took them a while to convince them of that, but it was a great idea. and then all of his ideas about the ice ages, you know, there's something entirely different from what he works with normally, but he could still contribute to something creative there too. And so I sort of admired that ability to really be creative in science. Then there were things he built, like the telescope that he built in high school that he used to look at the moons of Jupiter and everything. That was kind of cool.
Yeah.
And then he built a battery-powered Geiger counter. I guess I could have killed myself with the high voltage. There was a whole bank of 9-volt batteries. I think it was up to about 240 volts or something. It was higher than that. It seemed like it was...
Oh,
it seemed like it was about 20 batteries, and they're all 9 volts. So I think it was about 240 volts. That's what I remember anyway. But it was, maybe there was a current limiting thing in there. I don't remember. But it was sort of neat. It used one of his the ultraviolet detection vacuum tubes that he developed at work to detect the radioactivity from this uranium ore that he got from somewhere, I don't remember where. This is a top that was given to everyone for free at the Honeywell Research Center tour.
There.
Yay! Okay, well, this is a picture from one of the tours of the old Honeywell Research Center lab. And apparently it's from the glass shop. This is some sort of torch.
Good.
That's used for blowing glass. This
little girl down here is Wendy.
That's me.
This is Diane. And this is myself, Burgess. And this is Mom. And this little girl here is Janie, who's apparently didn't want to look at the camera, or there was some event happening that she didn't like. Obviously, Diane thinks there's something going on too, so like glass exploding or something, I don't know.
Yeah. What's the other one? The one with you and...
Oh, yeah, down here, the picture of myself and Daddy with the electron microscope, probably at the same lab tour.
It's a little younger. You look a little younger.
Yeah, according to the newspaper article, I'm 6 years old. See this one. Oh yeah, this one in the glass shop is spring 1964. This one is 1961. So it's a little bit different.
Say hi, Grandpa Bob. Zoom up on the face.
The Geological Society of America, GSA, an honored and well-respected international group of geologists, paleontologists, climatologists, mineralogists, seismologists, and mining and petroleum geologists, and all the other ologists, all searching for the truth about the Earth's great past and how this affects our future for all humankind. As you know, Dr. Robert Glenn Johnson have made many a cross-country travel to all corners of the United States and its neighbor, Canada, in the never-ending mission to seek the truth, to share the truth, and to prove the truth to other truth-seekers like yourself in the Truth-Seeking Geological Society of America.
Gonna take a sentimental journey. Gonna set my heart at ease. Gonna make a sentimental journey to renew old memories. Got my bag, got my reservation, spent each dime I could afford, like a child in wild anticipation, long to hear that all aboard. 7, that's the time we leave at 7. I'll be waiting up for heaven, counting every mile of railroad track that takes me back. Never thought my heart could be so yearning. Why did I decide to roam? Gotta take that sentimental journey, sentimental journey home.
I guess my first memory of Bob would be meeting him for the first time one very cold March when Wendy and I came out after she and I had first met. probably more impressionable than meeting Bob was how stinking cold it got here and stayed here.
Oh, camera, okay, what's that?
No, my first impression of Bob not knowing what to expect would be having heard that he was part of the Honeywell family of some sort and understanding they'd been here there for a long time. I was expecting someone, I don't know, something more than what I got, and that's not a slam by any means. I guess the point I'm trying to make is that my first impression was one that Bob was very down to earth and a very real person, and I thought that was neat. Not having known you very long, I guess there are a couple of things that really stick out in my mind. The first would be the infamous ever-escalating raccoon wars, which I don't know if you finally won or lost, but nonetheless, they make for some good stories. And the other, the epoxy. That made a big impression on me, too. The other single event, if you will, was all your help and encouragement on buying the house and then actually having to recite it, because you're there helping us every evening and every weekend for, seemed like forever. I think in reality it was about 6 weeks, and your help was genuinely appreciated, and I would hope that you've been told that before, if not, saying it again. The probably everlasting memory I'll ever have of you is, and this says a lot about you and your family in general, is that both you and Betty have put together a very fine family, and the one thing that I always see is that there is truly a genuine love for all of your family members by yourself, and I can see that that's genuinely reciprocated by all of your family.
Show me.
Show.
Does he write on your hand?
Yeah.
Are you being shy?
Does he play on the computer with you?
Yeah.
And what do you know to sing to Grandpa? What are you going to sing to Grandpa?
You want to sing the song for Grandpa Bob?
We sing two times.
Okay, so go ahead.
Okay.
How does the song go?
I sang it two times.
Okay, I'm ready.
Sing it now, honey. What do
happy.
You sing?
The house starts happy.
It does.
You sing it, honey.
There's some more verses.
What comes after happy?
Retirement.
What comes after retirement?
Then what?
Ooh.
Happy retirement to you?
Grandpa Bob was a scientist. Even when he was a boy, he was an astronomer. He studied the stars, planets, and galaxies. In 1941, when he was 18 years old, built his own telescope. The newspaper wrote an article about it. But Grandpa Bob was interested in the stars and planets 10 years earlier.
Oh, good.
1930, he wrote this song about a faraway place that he dreamed about.
Okay! Things I remember about Daddy are at the house on South Everett Lane,
And I remember I used to always look forward to have lunch because Daddy would always come home for lunch. And it was, I don't really remember a whole lot, but I do remember that he'd always come home for lunch. I remember pretty much nothing about the old lab. I do remember at least having a tour in the new lab when Pat came a year or so ago, and it was really neat to see what Daddy did there. But how about some older memories? There are a lot of little memories I guess I have, and one would be Daddy's old telescope that he had made when he was younger. And I remember he would bring it out in the front yard or the driveway of the house on March Circle, and I remember looking at Saturn through that. I mean, the first time I'd ever looked at Saturn, and I can always remember us going out at night to the edge of the driveway before Ridgedale was built to look at the stars and shooting stars, and we'd lay out blankets, and my friends would come over, you know, we'd get on the blankets and lay out, and it was like really neat because they never do that at their house. And look at the constellations or the northern lights. One thing that I'll always remember, and this is, you know, in the scientific niche of things, is that Daddy would always have an answer for everything. So, you know, you could ask him anything and he would know, and I thought, well, it's just normal for all parents to do this. You know, you ask your dad, so why does the water taste funny, and they just say because it's yucky. You know, he would say because it has all these minerals and all this stuff in it. He'd, you know, no. And if he didn't know, he'd have a good idea or something. But that was, I would always amaze friends of mine with my trivia and things that I knew that they would have never even thought to ask about. So that awareness, scientific awareness, was a neat thing. Daddy also always had an invention for any little problem around the house. And his main ingredient for that invention was, everyone, epoxy! Let's call him Epoxy Man or something, but everything could be fixed with epoxy and whatever else, and he'd always be rigging up his own solutions to whatever mechanical failures that happened about, and most of the time they'd work out great, and some other times eventually you really would have to call the plumber, or you really would have to take it into the gas station to get fixed or whatever. But that was always neat, to always see a solution to everything right at home. One thing that I guess I was trying to think was really special for me, that my love for outdoor hiking and fishing, I mean fishing, for love of fishing and not just for love of going up and drinking beer while you're out or for the love of going up and climbing to the peak, but I love fishing so much and trout, you know, fishing probably the most, and I know that's because Daddy taught me at a really, really early age, you know, how to cast out there in that little stream and let that fly float down just beyond the rock around the swirl, and load it up with just enough worm and whatever it was, and I've got really fond memories of technique building up in the bighorns and the upper Silas area there, and like the time when I saw the moose. I mean, I was only in fourth grade, and here I was, you know, the pro trout fisher person. But that was always really something I'll always love, and I know that our kids will really love. Another thing I just remembered was, whenever we'd go on vacation, you know, maps were the big deal, and everyone, you know, here I was 4 years younger than the youngest of the family. Everyone would map out where we're gonna go, and they'd always, you know, follow it on the map as you went, and as far as I was concerned, I could really care less about the map because all it was a bunch of lines and letters. And so subsequently, afterwards, everyone would always say, oh yeah, Wendy, you remember, well, you're kind of young, but we went to the Sulphur Springs, and then da-da-da, and I had like no concept of where all these things were because I didn't remember because I couldn't associate it with a map. Am I talking fast enough? And but now I have been able to really appreciate maps and love maps so much. And anytime we would go on a trip, like the last few times I went with the family, or plan my own trip, or how near or far I can always depend on a map and those skills that eventually I did learn, and just how much it really makes a difference. Anyhow, what would I like to say for the end of the tape? I'd like to say I had a blast making the video, and it's really been neat to hear everyone's side of your story, and I really wish you all the luck at the U, and hope that you'll be able to spend the time that you want to, when you want to, with family and the grandkids and all those folks. And I think that you've really earned your professorial position there, and I think it's really great for you. So, have a great time.
Well, I guess good luck, and don't let the fusion get too cold.
Bye. You gonna wave?
Good luck at the U, and hopefully we'll be at lunch together once in a while.
Happy retirement. I'm going to the U.
Have fun at the U. Happy retirement to you.
Hey, say hi, Michael. Say hi, Grandpa Bob.
Come on, have a good retirement. Have a good active retirement. You'll probably work harder than you ever did anyway.
Good luck, Bob, on your retirement, and I hope you enjoy yourself at the U, and I'm sure everyone at Honeywell is going to miss you.
And now that you're retiring, Robert, it's not really retirement, you know that. I know that. It's just going to be shifting into more time for some of the things that you really enjoy, such as geology papers, which you had to spend your evenings and weekends working on. Now you can do those during the day and even in a spot all allocated for your own over at the university. Prestige. And that other... this is going to be shown January 1st. Now I can say it, this high fusion thing that you're working on. As long as you were officially an employee of Honeywell, I guess that was a no-no to talk about. But,
Hi, cold fusion.
What'd I say? Wrong, cold fusion, sorry. That's as bad as my left and my right and my north and my south. I'm sorry, that's always been a hard, hard thing. Couldn't read maps and couldn't say it straight. And I guess that's it. Good luck.
Bye.
Love ya.
Okay. Wow, it's gonna be weird coming home from school and you being there. I don't know what to say. It's gonna be weird having you around, especially since there's only gonna be half a year for me to be around when you're around too at the same time. I hope the hikes don't ever end, and I know that there won't be, that they won't come to a complete end, because, I mean, that's what you love and that's what I love, and so we both love, and I don't know what to say. Happy retirement. I love you.
Good luck at the U. I hope it can be as rewarding and challenging as your tenure at Honeywell. Bye.
Bye-bye. Happy retirement! I love you!
What do you want to say to Grandpa, Dan? I want to go here to this summer. I can.
Okay. What do you want to say to Grandpa?
What?
What do you want to say to Grandpa Bob now?
Bye.
Say it louder. Say
bye. Happy New Year's.
Perfect.
Happy retirement, Bob.
Thanks. Bye.
That's good. I just had to zoom in on this beautiful smile.
Dad, I just want you to know
I really love you, Dad.
Happy retirement, Grandma Bob.